Omer is not only an expert in media, but also how people should be using this media and how we should think about the impact we're having on the way we live our lives as human beings. So welcome.
Thank you.
Omer.
Thanks. Hi, everyone. So if you see me using my phone, it's because my notes are on my phone. It's not because I'm live tweeting my speech, okay? So I got to Barcelona yesterday morning, very early in the morning, and I was very, very sleepy. So the first thing I did was I got to my hotel and I went to sleep, or I tried to go to sleep. The second I got to sleep, a huge protest rolled by, a massive protest, and it woke me up. These guys weren't stopping. They were shouting and screaming and blah, 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 blah. So I went downstairs and I asked the guys at the hotel, what is this protest about? It was a protest against the banks. Okay, so now I was awake. I went on my Twitter feed. I looked at my Twitter feed, and there's a huge scandal in the UK now about the banks and the politicians and who rigged the rates and who did what. Okay, now I'm even wider awake and a little depressed, huh? So then I looked at the newspapers. Today is Independence Day in the States. And so I looked at the newspapers, the American newspapers, and they're full of very glum and sad articles saying, where is our country going? What has happened to us? Look at the state of the nation. And at this point, I was so depressed that I went back to sleep. Okay, so I had a nice nap for a while. And then I thought about, what am I gonna talk to you guys today? Well, what I wanna talk to you guys about is this kind of situation, right? We see all of this stuff happening around us, and what I think is happening, in a sense, is that the contracts that govern the relationships between institutions and individuals are breaking down. The social contracts that kind of order our lives. And as a result, the relationships between institutions and individuals are breaking down. And for us as marketers, I think it's very important to kind of think about that, because it leaves us very threatened. And it gets to the heart of what we're trying to do in terms of earning trust and building relationships and kind of bridging that gap between institutions and individuals. So let me talk about social contracts for a second. Very, very simple terms. In the beginning, a long time ago, what kind of social contract did we have? I think we had a social contract focused on the idea of subsistence. That if you play by the rules and you work hard, you will earn enough bread to live. And you'll have a place, and maybe the guys that run the economy won't swoop in one day and kill you. That was kind of the social contract. Then we came to the Industrial Age, and everything changed. And all of a sudden, we developed this new social contract. And I'm going to sum it up for you in 5 words. More, bigger, faster, cheaper, now. And that's what the Industrial Age gave us. And I think if you think back with me, over the last 50 years, 100 years, we can explain the history of innovation using these 5 words. More, bigger, faster, cheaper, now. Everything from the birth of the post-war consumer, which was about more, to the idea of the mall. I was driving here in the taxi. There's a very nice big mall up the road here. It's about bigger. The rise of fast fashion, fast food, supersized meal, faster, cheap credit, the stuff that brought down the global economy, cheaper. And the rise of this wonderful kind of digital economy. It's about now, having things right now. I can download 10,000 apps on my iPhone in the blink of an eye. So more, bigger, faster, cheaper now. And I think the idea behind the social contract of the Industrial Age was that if you play by the rules and if you work hard, the benefit will be that you get more, bigger, faster, cheaper now. You live a life of affluence. And maybe you've seen it happen in this city, in Barcelona, over the last 50 years. When I go back home to Pakistan, my city is full of new buildings and malls and car dealerships. More, bigger, faster, cheaper now. So those are the benefits of that contract. And if you play by the rules, maybe you get that level of affluence a little bit. But there are also costs. And I think today we're coming face to face with some of those costs. So what are some of those costs? It's the stuff that I heard on the news yesterday and in my Twitter feed. Endless financial crises, political gridlock, environmental contamination and destruction, the social polarization, mass unemployment, lost generations, people that don't feel like they have a future. And so maybe if we think about what broke this contract, if we think about why people distrust institutions so much today, and I'll just give you two numbers about how much people actually distrust institutions. We do a study every year called Meaningful Brands, and we talk to 50,000 people across the world. And what we find is just 20% of brands are seen to have a notable positive impact on people's lives. Number one. Number two, the majority of people wouldn't care across the world if 80% of brands, 70 to 80% of brands, disappeared tomorrow. It's a broken relationship. People aren't trusting in the institutions, and especially not in the brands behind the contracts that they are offered. And so, if people distrust institutions, maybe it's for a good reason. They're getting more, bigger, faster, cheaper now, but they're also facing a very real set of costs in their lives. And so, what I think is happening is that people's values are beginning to change, and they're beginning to demand a very different set of elements. They're beginning to, and I'll sum it up for you in another five words. They're beginning to demand that institutions make them fitter, smarter, wiser, tougher, closer. That institutions actually play a meaningful, positive role in their lives, and institutions actually make a difference to them. And so, how do you do that? How do you get there? If people are asking not just for more, bigger, faster, cheaper, but better, fundamentally better in human terms, how do we get there? How do we do that? We often think that we don't know how to do that. So I'm going to offer you, I think, eight principles. Okay? And the first principles are, the first four are functional principles. They're about what we do, not how we do it. What we do and how we think about it, maybe. So, the first principle I want to offer you is the idea of having an ambition. Most of our organizations, and maybe even marketing campaigns, have some kind of vision behind them. I'll give you one of my favorite examples of a vision statement. One of the biggest hotels companies in the world, vision statement is, we want to be the best hotel operator in the world. What does that mean? It doesn't mean anything. If you think about my terms, smarter, fitter, tougher, closer, wiser, it has absolutely no meaning in those terms. It doesn't mean anything to people. So I think the first step is beginning to craft what I call an ambition. An ambition talks to people in human terms, and it defines your own goals in human terms. So maybe some of you know this company in the States called Lululemon. They make yoga gear and athletic gear and all kinds of stuff. They have a very interesting statement, and it's not really a vision. They say, we make components for people to live healthier lives. It's about fitness. And it's very much about fitness in human terms. It's not just we want to be the world's biggest athletic goods manufacturer, we want to be the world's best yoga company. No, it's about the impact on people in human terms. We want to create components for people to live healthier, fitter lives. That's an ambition. It's not just a vision. The second thing that I think is really important is to have a set of constraints, not just a strategy. So a strategy is a plan of action about what you're going to do. A constraint, set of constraints, is a set of actions that you will never undertake, stuff that you're never going to let happen. So if we think about a company, one of the most interesting companies to me in the world, it's Whole Foods, right? So some of you guys have probably been to a Whole Foods store. What made Whole Foods so different? Whole Foods started with a proposition that was radical, at least at the time that it started. And they said, we're not going to use artificial colors. We're not going to use artificial ingredients. Very simple. The two things that we'll never, ever do. And that was the foundation of a business that was radically, totally disruptive, because it changed the terms of the game, and it let them begin to earn people's trust. It let them begin to matter in human terms. So the third thing that I would recommend is to have a set of imperatives, not just a set of objectives. So objectives, what we want to accomplish this month, quarter, year, in the short term. Imperatives are stuff that we always want to do. So take this phone, for example. What makes it so Apple-y? It's the rounded corners. It's the fact that it only has one button. It's the fact that it only uses very high quality materials. These are Steve Jobs's imperatives. He never compromised on them. A lot of the other manufacturers have objectives. We're going to sell X many phones this year. Maybe we'll make a slightly cooler one next year. They have never had imperatives. Stuff that will always happen. When you think about things in terms of imperatives, you immediately have to think about things that last, things that matter to people because they're timeless. And that's what this stuff, Apple stuff, ends up being. That's why it's in design museums around the world today. So that's kind of functional stuff, how you should think about the art of mattering to people. Let me talk a bit about structural stuff. How do we organize to matter to people, to make a difference? I think the most basic thing, and maybe it's a word that you guys have heard a lot, is openness. We have to build organizations, whether they're kind of giant bureaucracies or even little marketing campaigns, that are much more open than they were yesterday. So my favorite example of this from the last couple of years is the platform that Starbucks set up called My Starbucks Idea. And so the idea was that anybody could submit ideas to Starbucks. And you know what? Most of the, and you're probably thinking most of the ideas are going to be crap. And most of the ideas were crap. But a few of the ideas were really, really good. And one of the ideas was for Starbucks to make a brand of instant coffee, a very high quality brand of instant coffee. Today, that idea has turned into Starbucks Via. It was at every Starbucks store in the world. It's a $1 billion business that Starbucks earned through the power of openness. So I think the first thing you have to do if you want to matter to people is be open enough to hear their voices and let them tell you what you're doing that is not good enough, or what they really want, or how you're not mattering to them. And we can discuss many more radical and interesting examples of openness, for sure. Looking around the crowd, I'm sure that many of you guys know things like Threadless or Kiva or Kickstarter, right? Even more kind of open platforms. The second thing that I think is really important, and this is where, you know, digital stuff gets really important, is experimentation. So we often treat innovation, marketing, development, as a game of kind of industrial age innovation, right? Somebody has a big idea. Then it takes 6 months for something to happen. Other people add to it. A year later, somebody approves it, and then the thing comes out. That's ridiculous. With digital technologies, we can innovate like that, right? 1,000 times a day. So what is Google famous for? Experimenting, right? The bucket test that it does. I think the statistic, I don't remember the numbers, but the idea is that Google experiments more in a month than most companies do in a decade, right? So why don't we treat the stuff that we're doing in a much more experimental way and reach out to people and say, hey, we're going to run this experiment. Can you tell us? Does this experiment matter to you? Does it work? The next principle that I think is really important is to begin thinking in circular terms. So we often still think in linear terms, right? The terms of the assembly line. I've made this awesome thing. It's going to see the light of day. People are going to love it. It's a linear way of thinking. If we think in circular terms, we begin to think very differently. So what do I mean by circular terms? Let me give you a radical example. Nike's vision for the next decade is that it wants to manufacture shoes, sells you a pair of shoes, you wear the shoes out, you go back to a Nike town, you give the shoes back to Nike, and from that pair of shoes, Nike remanufactures a new pair of shoes. So it's recycling the shoes, in a way. That's circular thinking. That's circular production. And to me, that's totally radical. And we need kind of digital stuff to help us get more circular. We need digital stuff to help us close the loop between institutions and individuals. I think my last principle is that you got to make it count. So, you know, we're often in the marketing world obsessed with the idea of trust. Say, why can't we earn people's trust? Why don't they trust us? I think the truth is pretty simple. If we are not accountable, anything that is not accountable, anybody that is not accountable, does not earn trust. And to be accountable, you have to count stuff that matters. And I'll give you a very, what I think is probably the coolest example of that, that I was just, that I've been discussing for the last couple of weeks with people, is Nike Fuel, right? It's a band which tracks how many kind of miles you run and this kind of stuff. It helps you become more accountable. And it keeps Nike accountable. It creates kind of a virtuous circle of accountability because it counts stuff that matters. It doesn't just count how many times you viewed an ad. It doesn't just count how many impressions you've given a marketing agency. It counts how much fitter you are becoming. It counts how much better off you are in human terms. Right? So this new social contract, fitter, smarter, closer, tougher, wiser, I think our challenge is taking a quantum leap into that kind of era and really helping build the tools and the structures that can make people's lives meaningfully better. Because I think that's what they're demanding. And that's what they're beginning to kind of, you know, pound down the doors of yesterday's institutions and ask for. And I think unless we can do that, we are going to be less and less relevant to them. But the flip side is, you know, what we find is that brands that can do that tend to disruptively outperform their competitors, not just by like tens of percent, but by hundreds of percent. So I think there's a tremendous opportunity, and I think it's up to us to take it. So thank you. That's my talk, and I'm happy to take your questions. Thank you.
Questions, y para los que quieren preguntar en castellano, estoy dispuesto a ofrecer mis servicios como traductor, que soy fatal, pero por lo menos mejor, es más fácil hacer la pregunta. So if there's some Spanish questions, I will do my best to translate.
Certainly.
You work in the from the agency perspective. How successful are you in actually making companies take the path of transcendence? I mean, is it something that an agency can do for a customer, or really, if the customer doesn't have it inside, it's impossible?
So I run the lab, and we deliberately, I think, stay quite far away, because our job is to help reinvent these things. Now, what I can tell you is that since we have kind of come up with the meaningful brands approach, it's been quite successful. I mean, look at it in broad terms for a second. If you know that this kind of unrest is growing in the world, if we know that so many consumers don't trust brands, you know, there are definitely a very large number of companies out there that get it. And some of them are way ahead of the marketing world, right? So if you look at somebody like, I don't know, Interface Carpets, who pioneered a circular model of carpet production, you look at arguably somebody like Unilever, right? There are many companies that are kind of leaping ahead. And so I think the demand is very much there, absolutely, if that makes sense. Yeah?
Now, who has a challenge at the moment? There's a lot of guru talent you could avail of with some specific challenge you have right at the moment. Can make life difficult for Umair. Bring it down from
as
the generic
do.
To the tangible. What?
Hi, very interesting. Profound change like the kind you're talking about also often evokes profound resistance.
Sure.
What are some of the obstacles that you see to this, in fact, very positive and inspiring picture. What is going to make it tougher than if there were no resistance at all? And where does the resistance come from? What are some of the obstacles?
So,
not
so
only in the States, but maybe also in other parts of the world, which are quite different.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, I think I think the biggest obstacle is that we have to build new institutions, right? This is not going to happen overnight. It's going to take a decade. And in that decade, we're going to see increasing frustration coming from people. So to the last question, you know, how much demand is there really for this kind of thing? There's a huge amount of demand for it. But the institutions that are there already, you know, they don't go away overnight. So some of them will change slowly. Some of them will take 5 years to change. Some of them will not make it at all. And so this process of transition is going to be, I think, very messy for countries, for companies, and for people. You know, and it's fraught with all kinds of tension, right? How much do we invest in the new model versus the old model? You know, how do we measure the returns of the new model versus the old model? I mean, we can go down a very long list of tensions, but every institution in the world these days is kind of facing a lot of these tensions, you know, and countries and companies are making progress in very kind of strange and funny ways. So to give you a non-marketing example, to give you an economic example, you know, GDP, the way of counting the economy, was invented in the States with some help from the UK. The countries that are reinventing it already are India and China, right? And in Europe, we're kind of, in many parts of Europe, we are still following kind of the Anglo-American model, right? And those guys are going in a completely different direction now. It's a big question, right? And so I think we have to at least, whatever institution we're part of, we at least have to take a position. How much do we want to embrace this change or not? Because I think the guys that don't survive are the guys that are just kind of going to go with the flow, right? They're not going to take a position. They're going to be the followers. Before you know it, the tide will kind of sweep them under. And we see it happening already, right? I mean, 10 years ago, what was Apple? Nothing. 10 years ago, what was Nokia? The very top of the game. Now, today, like that. Right? So, speed of change is very, very, very fast.
Hello. You have talked about brands.
Mm-hmm.
How do you apply all this to governments?
To?
Governments.
Oh, to governments. I think that we are applying it to governments, and I think that we apply it to governments in much the same way that we apply it to other institutions, right? So governments have brands as well. Political parties have brands as well. And the real question that we're asking is, do any of your interactions with an institution result in you being better off in these terms, fitter, smarter, wiser, closer, tougher? We can ask that about any institution. Huh? Doesn't have to be Apple, doesn't have to be Nike. Can be the Democratic Party in the States. Can be the government of England. Could be the Bank of England, right? Does the Bank of England make you more financially secure? We can ask many questions about the elements of human well-being to many different kinds of institutions. What we tend to find is a pattern, and that's why people are so fed up with institutions. No matter what kind of industry we're in or what kind of nation we're in, people want this much. Okay, where a perfect life is like this much, people want this much. They don't want a perfect life. They don't want a utopian kind of existence. They want a nice life, a good life, a comfortable life. But they feel, and I think they're right, institutions are only giving them about this much. And so there's a big gap that we consistently tend to find between people's expectations of institutions in terms of well-being and the results that they're able to deliver. And I think that's why people distrust institutions. I mean, take a look around. Right? I mean, when I got, like I said, the first thing that happened to me when I got to Barcelona was a big protest. I opened the newspaper and people are, you know, our country's broken about the States. So, you know, to put it in hard terms, yeah.
Hi. Do you think there is a fundamental discrepancy between trust? I mean, marketing and consumers, there are two sides. I mean, would you propose to be us to get consumers and companies closer that they were before? Because I mean, these last 10 years have been devastating.
I
agree totally. But 20 years ago, 30 years ago, there was still a gap.
How
do you see? Do you see the gap increasing or getting?
No, that's a very good question. Look, trust in institutions has actually been falling for like 3 decades in most of the advanced world, right? So this is not about this financial crisis. It's a longer term problem. And what we really have to do is heal that gap. If we're going to be the people that are helping build relationships and helping earn trust, we have to bridge that gap. And it's a long-standing gap, which is why I talk to you guys about social contracts, not about kind of the financial crisis or about tools or whatever, because I want to give you guys the bigger picture. And the context is that that relationship has been decaying for many decades. And if we want to heal it, we probably have to play a fundamentally different role in people's lives. And it has to be about the things that earn trust, because they make people really, you know, kind of tangibly better off. Does that answer your question? Yeah, more or less. Okay.
Hello, good morning. Right. I love the concept of meaningful branding, but I don't remember when. I think last year.
Yep.
Pepsi has a new strategy, and they launched. You know, what they did was to use mainly all the budget of the marketing actions in a non-profit organization throughout the world.
Yep.
And this year, after this campaign, the sale of the Pepsi fell down, and for the first time, Coke, Diet Coke, won the place, the second place in the U.S.
Yep.
So it is true, and I love the concept, but the reality is still too far?
No, I think that, so we're talking about two very different things. So, excuse me, a meaningful brand is not Pepsi making lots of soft drinks and then saying we're going to donate a few million bucks to charity. It's not a meaningful brand. That's still about persuasion. A meaningful brand is about actually playing a positive role in people's lives. And that's what we go out and measure. So we don't ask people, do you trust Pepsi more because they gave $5 million to save the children? No. We ask people, does Pepsi make a difference in your life in XYZ kind of way? And so the truth is Pepsi is not making a positive difference to people's lives in those kinds of ways, in the scales under which we measure it. And that is why Pepsi is failing to build a meaningful brand. And that is why, if you ask me, Pepsi's performance is suffering. And now Indira Nooyi is having a difficult time. Because I think she thought that she could build a kind of parallel universe where Pepsi would be seen to be doing many good and interesting things. And she could fund this parallel universe with a bit of change, right? With maybe a total investment of $40 to $50 million, something like that, with Pepsi Refresh and all of the NGO investments and all of this kind of thing. But the truth is, the core of the business didn't change at all. It's still just Pepsi, huh? And so when we ask people, does this stuff play a different role in your lives? The answer is no, because it doesn't. It's the same thing. So for me, that's a case study of how not to build a meaningful brand. You have to do stuff, not just kind of, put it in a little corner and create the perception. So people can see through it now. Huh? Yeah?
Which is, I guess, the parallel of buying flowers for your company. If you do it once, they look at you, what did you do wrong?
Yeah, exactly.
So you signal the wrong thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sorry to interrupt.
Please.
I could give you another example exactly what you're saying. I think it was 4 or 5 months ago in Sweden. Ingvar Kamprad, the owner and of IKEA, he has been followed by news media in Sweden for many years about his connections to the Nazi party 40, 50, 60 years ago.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of turbulence in media a couple of months ago. And what he did at that time was to go out and basically pay off in a big project. I think it was in Africa or something. He put in some, 50 million kroner or something like that, just to pay off the 2 years down on the media. And that's totally, totally, totally stupid to do that. I mean,
that's an interesting example. I mean, we see, so I'll give you a similar example, which is Whole Foods. Okay, so Whole Foods, in terms of being a meaningful brand, does pretty radical stuff. So you can go to their shops, and they have like workshops and seminars, and they'll take care of your kids. So they do all kinds of stuff which is active, that really makes people's lives better. But then the CEO, John Mackey, is notorious for kind of union busting, for all kinds of, you know, hardcore stuff that people really, really, especially Whole Foods customers, because they're very liberal guys, really, really shrink away from. And we see this reflected. Sense that people appreciate the stuff that Whole Foods does for their lives, but they also really are beginning to kind of devalue Whole Foods and beginning to distrust them a little bit. Because the actions are not totally consistent. On the one hand, Whole Foods is saying we're going to make your lives better, and on the other hand, the people that it employs is not making their lives any better. So this inconsistency is leading to kind of Whole Foods perform lower on the scale of meaningful brands than it probably should. So it's a related example.
Hello. Hi. Now, in this social world we are now, where the brands communicate with the consumers, and in fact the consumers, the brand is trust because it's when it's communicating with the consumers.
Yep.
What is going to be the advertising and media future? What do you think about?
Well, listen, there's a small question, huh? easy question. Listen, I think that we have to get serious, okay? I think that do you think advertising matters? Do you think advertising matters? I'm asking you. Do you think so?
You want me to answer the question?
So okay. Let me just channel the voice of the 50,000 people that we survey for meaningful brands. They kind of indifferent, right? So the way that I put it is that advertising can get you from orthodox communications, if you like, can get you from irrelevance to indifference, okay? Can get you from being totally irrelevant to people's lives to them kind of saying, I know that guy, I had a conversation in a bar with him, so what? But it can't get you from indifference to really a positive sense of emotion about that thing anymore. It's very hard to find examples of companies who have got some kind of right?
Well, I think
this is a good example.
This
right?
is a good example.
This is how
advertising creates.
This is how people see advertising, right? It's like, what are you doing? Right? So that's how people see it, right? And it maybe in a nice sense, like I said, it's like you meet the guy at the bar, you have a nice conversation with him, okay, well, so what? 2 days later you're like, so what? I met that guy, it doesn't really make a difference in my life. So it gets you from irrelevance to indifference, to the point where you actively don't hate the company, to the point where you're like, oh, okay, maybe. But it can't get you further than that. And that's what we find time and time and time again in meaningful brands. The brands that people, let me put it to you differently. In meaningful brands, we ask people a very simple question. Would you care if this company disappeared tomorrow? That's it. The only companies that people care about are the ones that also make a positive difference in their lives. The ones that people can also say, that company made me fitter, smarter, closer, happier in some way. So if you're asking me, what is the future of marketing? It's in between those two things. Do I care if this company disappears tomorrow? Did it actually benefit me in human terms? Yeah?
I think we've come to the end of our program schedule. Thank you very much for taking the questions and sharing this with us.
Well, thanks for having me. Thank you.
And for me, voy a cambiar a casa cada año. Y se sienten en salas como esta, y muchas se sienten ahí con los brazos cruzados y buscan una inclinación de los hombros. Yo creo que 10% de inclinación muestra la apatía perfecto. Pero habéis venido aquí, los ponentes habéis compartido sus ideas. Yo lo que pido de vosotros
es que tomáis un minuto para pensar en cómo vais a cambiar algo respecto a lo que has aprendido aquí. Hemos oído de responsabilidad personal, de la gente libre. Hemos oído de arguiño. La capacidad ahora está en las manos. Tenemos las herramientas para hacer estos cambios. Y Umair dice que buscamos meaningful brands, marcas que dicen no a cosas. Y quizás para mí, lo más difícil para vosotros, integridad personal. Si no has dicho no en los últimos 4 horas, es que no tienes integridad personal. Si no dices no, tú estás siguiendo los valores de las personas a tu alrededor. Hasta que tú dices no más que dices sí, no estás marcando tu propia vida con tu propia integridad. Y este de las marcas y este de marketing convierte en cada uno de nosotros. Si sois el representante de marketing en vuestras empresas, tu manera de ser y ser íntegro significa decir no a la mayor parte de las ofertas que tienes cada día. Y esta cambia vida. No, mi petición es que no vayáis de aquí habiendo pasado solo un buen día, pero que pensáis y aplicáis estas ideas a vuestras vidas. Y mañana dices no más que dices sí a las cosas y empecéis a marcar tus propios valores como la línea de actuación de vuestras vidas. Y paso la palabra a José Luis.